Good afternoon. Welcome to the webinar Managing Cervical Lesions Based on Liquid-Based Cytology, Pap Smear, a knowledge-sharing initiative by Jackson Pal with Lalita Memorial Hospital Infertility Center, Rewari, supported by Rewari Obstetrician and Gynecology Society. On behalf of Jackson Pal Pharmaceuticals Limited, makers of cell protector Lycored to prevent cancer, as lycopene in Lycored has anti-oncogenic properties, JP-Tone iron syrup, and for calcium needs, NariCal tablets. I'm Dr. Vipin Tyagi, along with my teammates, Dr. Deepika Chhabra and Mr. Amit Saxena. Thanks, convener, Dr. Seema Mittal, for organizing this webinar. Dr. Seema Mittal is Director, Lalita Memorial Hospital Infertility Center, Rewari, Infertility and Endoscopy Specialist, past president, ROGS. Welcome all the esteemed faculty present with us today. We thank ICOG for the accreditation of one ICOG point to all attendees of this webinar. Welcome to all attendees. Please post your queries by text in the Q&A box to be answered at the end. Please note, this webinar is streaming on Facebook Live and the recording will remain on Jackson Pal's YouTube channel for reference and promotion. I will now request Dr. Seema Mittal to kindly initiate the session.
Thank you, Dr. Vipin. Thank you, Deepika ji. And it's indeed my pleasure to have with us Dr. Poonam Shivkumar. Ma'am doesn't need an introduction. And we have been really lucky to have worked with Dr. Poonam Shivkumar. And Dr. Anubhuti will shortly be introducing ma'am. Before that, I just want to say that why we had this webinar today. Because we have been doing lots of LBCs and pap smear of late. But when it comes to interpretation, it's always dicey thing. Sometimes the HPV is coming positive, whether we should operate, we should take for colposcopy, cone biopsy. So today we have two master speakers who are dedicatedly working in this field, Dr. Poonam and Dr. Sarita from Safdarjung Hospital. So all of our queries will be answered probably by the presentations. In the end, if you have any queries, the experts will be present here to answer all the queries. So I request Dr. Anubhuti, our young, energetic friend from Rewari OBGYN Society, to introduce Dr. Poonam Shivkumar. Over to you, Anubhuti.
Good afternoon, ma'am, and good afternoon to all the faculty present here. It is an immense pleasure for me to introduce Dr. Poonam Verma Shivkumar, ma'am. She is a professor and head of Obstetrician and Gynecology Society and Sevagram Wardha. And she's also a president of Sevagram Wardha, Obstetrician and Gynecology Society. She has had an advanced training in sexual health and reproductive health from Uppsala University, Sweden, and also clinical skills trainers training from emergency ops care from Vellore. She's a principal investigator for PPH bundle project in Harvard University, misoprostol and oxytocin labor induction in university in Liverpool as well, and many other projects are there by her name. She's also a co-investigator for hypertensive pregnancy in community, ICMR, and non-surgical contraceptive, Oregana University, USA. Ma'am is also a TAG member in Inland India CLEN, biomedical research in HIV ICMR. She's a resource person and expert for GOI and GOM for national guidelines development in maternal health, nodal officer on FBMDR committee, member of core committee for MCH diploma IGNU, and also a contributor in GOI toolkit and clinical skills lab manual. Ma'am has also received many awards. Some by her name are Doctor's Award for Management of Anemia, Special Certificate for Emergency Ops Care Project in GOM, and Best Human Service in CAD Pulgaon. She has also received Best Doctor Award by Lions Club. Ma'am has also given about 126 guest lectures, has presented many papers, and chaired many international and national conferences as IMA. And the list goes on. I welcome you, ma'am, to discuss the topic of evaluation of cervical lesions by pap smear and liquid-based cytology and beyond.
Over to you, Poonam, ma'am. Thank you, Anubhuti.
Thank you, Anubhuti, for that introduction. I really don't know whether I really deserve that. Thank you, Seema, at the outset for inviting me. And it is a topic which is very close to our heart. So I'll just share my screen in a minute. So a very good afternoon to all who are present here, my seniors, my juniors, colleagues and friends. Today, what I'm going to talk to you is about evaluation of cervical lesions using pap smear, liquid-based cytology and beyond. I bring greetings again from Mahatma Gandhi Institute of Medical Sciences, an institute which still follows ethics and believes in community medical health. Now, let's first go back to our anatomy knowledge. And in a minute, I would like to tell you that we all know that the cervix is made up of two parts, ectocervix and endocervix. It's the ectocervix which projects in the vagina, whereas endocervix stays up. Ectocervix opens by external os in the vagina, the area which is most prone for infection, and endocervix and ectocervix are connected by an opening which is let me give you an example that there are two parts, endocervix, ectocervix. Ecto and endo are connected by a canal. So there's a canal from ectocervix to endocervix. Ectocervix opens out by external os in the vagina, and endocervix opens in the uterus by internal os. Okay. So once we know this anatomy, we also need to know that endocervix is lined by columnar epithelium and ectocervix is lined by stratified squamous epithelium. And the junction between the squamous and columnar epithelium is called squamo-columnar junction. And this is the junction which is actually very, very prone whenever there are any pre-malignant or malignant changes. Now, in this, we also need to know certain things. So this is the look. And if you see, this is the ectocervical epithelium, which is a stratified squamous. Before we go ahead, there are a few things I would like to say, that the squamo-columnar junction, this junction actually is inside most of the time. But as we become pubertal, because of the influence of estrogen, this squamous epithelium comes outside and makes a new squamo-columnar junction. So the area between the original squamo-columnar junction and the newly formed squamo-columnar junction is the one which is called transformation zone, where cells are undergoing metaplasia. And this is the junction, or this is the zone which is highly prone for developing any kind of malignant or pre-malignant change. So in nutshell, ectocervix and endocervix joined together by squamocolumnar junction. Squamocolumnar junction moves outside under the influence of hormone, makes a new squamocolumnar junction, and the area between the original and newly formed squamocolumnar junction is transformation zone, which is the zone very important for pre-malignant and malignant changes. Now, when we come on to cervical lesions, what are we talking about? We're talking about some benign lesions like inflammation, cervicitis. We're talking about erosions, polyps. We talk about pre-malignant lesions, which are cervical intraepithelial neoplasia, 1, 2, or 3 variety. And we are talking about malignant lesions, which are squamous cell carcinoma and adenocarcinoma. And we all know that squamous cell carcinoma is this carcinoma which develops on the ectocervix. It is almost 95%, and adenocarcinoma is in the endocervix, which is nearly 5%. These are other variety of lesions what we see in the cervix, and each one are of very, very great importance because they create some or the other morbidity in the women. So if it is inflammatory, which happens in pelvic inflammatory disease, cervicitis, which could be acute, chronic, cervix is highly inflamed. And especially when we see the infection like trichomonas, which causes a strawberry cervix, this highly irritating discharge which comes out, so it's inflammatory. We find several nepotiences because of inflammation. The gland duct closes and the gland secretion collects. So you see pearly white areas all over the cervix, and that is nepotiensis. We see cervical erosions, which could be because of infection, hormonal effect, pre-malignant or malignant lesion. But one thing what we need to know is that we should not try to treat ectropion. Ectropion is something where, because of fibrosis or because of injury, the endocervical epithelium turns out. So it's something everting out like this. But if you treat this, you cauterize it, you will end up in cervical stenosis. So one has to be very sure whether it is ectropion or it is erosion. Erosion will not show the eversion. It will not show that the whole epithelium has come out. Only ectropion will show, and it is a clinical finding which can be very well assessed. There is ulcerative lesion which could be because of STDs, pre-malignant lesion, malignant lesion. There would be polyps which could be cervical polyp, fibroids, or from the endometrium fibroid polyps are protruding out. Or there could be irregular bleeding growths, which could be malignancy. So there is a huge big list of cervical lesions which we can diagnose by doing several methods. Now let's see, this is what I wanted to show, that these are the various lesions and how do they look like. So you can see the normal one, you can see CIN1, CIN2, CIN3, malignancy, and in one cervix I have tried my level best to show how is a normal cervix, how is low-grade CIN, how is high-grade CIN, and carcinoma. Now, once you know the lesion, why are we concerned about the cervical lesion? So we are concerned because cervix is most prone for trauma during childbirth, during intercourse, infections, pre-malignant and malignant changes. And cervical malignancy is one of the commonest genital tract cancer. So if you go into the literature, you will find that some people say that if you talk about a female, the breast cancer tops and then comes the cervical malignancy. And if you see further literature, you will find that globally it comes either third or fourth common genital cancer, where in some areas lung cancer is more or colon cancer is more. But in India, the registry says that first is breast cancer and second is cervical cancer. So you can imagine the burden of malignancy which is there. But very interesting thing about cervix is that pre-malignant changes, they take time to convert into malignancy. So you have a good period where you can treat these women. Pre-malignant changes can be detected very easily because ectocervix is all visualized outside. So it is easily accessible, you can see that. Universal screening is possible because we can see the cervix and do several tests. And cervical malignancy is known that it can be prevented if detected in pre-malignant stage. It can be at least downstage if detected by the paramedical worker in early stage. And it can be treated if it is detected in stage 1A. Now, in India, cervical cancer contributes. This is the latest data I am telling you, and I am not going to go into those technical details, but I am going to talk to you very practical things. So in India, cervical cancer contributes approximately 6 to 29% of all cancer in the women. The age-adjusted incidence rate of cervical cancer varies widely amongst registries. Highest is in Mizoram and lowest is in Dibrugarh. Now, coming on to what are the risk factors where you have to be extremely careful in your smears and all. One is genital infection with high risk HPV infection. So this is the main source. Then early onset sexual activity, multiple sexual partner, too frequent cigarette smoking, immunocompromised, low socioeconomic status, multiparity, prolonged use of oral contraceptive. These are some very important risk factor, but the most common one is HPV virus. So So let's have one quick look on the HPV virus. Now, we all know that this is a non-enveloped DNA virus which infects skin and mucosa. The circular double-stranded viral genome is approximately 8 kb in length. And if you look into the picture, it has got a lipid membrane which makes it very resistant. It has a nucleocapsid virus genome which contains integrase and reverse transcriptase. And it has a glycoprotein 120 and 41. There are three varieties depending on its oncogenic potential: low, intermediate, and high. The low is 6 and 11, which we commonly talk about. High is 16 and 18, which we commonly talk about. But these are several ones which have been detected till now. So it's very important to do cervical screening. Now, if you go into the literature, friends, you will find, look at it. There are number of guidelines going on. Every state has its own guideline. Every country has its own guideline. Worldwide, several organizations have suggested so much. So we all get confused. What are we supposed to do? So in 2020, this particular guideline from American Cancer Society has come up. So we have left all the other guidelines and all of us are following these guidelines, which clearly says that if the woman is 21 to 24, even if she is sexually active, no screening is required. Between 25 to 29, HPV test every 5 years, HPV Pap co-test every 5 years, or if you're doing only Pap test, that is also acceptable every 3 years. Fine. So you do 25 years, then you wait 6, 7, and 28th year, you are going to do another test. So the concept that, you know, a woman comes to you, you did pap smear, everything was normal, then you called her nani, in annual screening, you again do it, and you again do it. So you do, that's your choice, but the recommendation is that every 3 years you should do pap smear testing, and if you have tested for HPV, then every 5 years you can do HPV. Between age 30 to 65, HPV test every 5 years, HPV Pap co-test every 5 years, and Pap test every 3 years, so nothing changes here. But age 65 and older, no screening if your series of prior tests were normal. Then there is no screening unless she has some symptoms and you have to go ahead with the screening. So this is the most accepted guidelines. And why these guidelines have been made? Because finally, government has to pay for it. So one has to understand that doing a universal screening, you minimize according to the incidence of positivity what you get. So that is why this particular guideline has come up. Now, what are the various methods by which we do cervical screening? So let's go on to a lower setting and let's go on to a higher setting of healthcare. In lower settings, you do clinical examination, VIA, which is called visual inspection using acetic acid, VIAM, visual inspection using acetic acid with magnification, and VILI, which is visual inspection using Ugol's iodine. This is done. And any positivity, early identification and their referral to the higher hospital is to be done. And believe me, government is training paramedical workers and the nurses to do these kind of tests, VILI. You have to do these tests and ensure that the moment you find it positive, you refer them directly to the higher center. When she goes to the higher setting, of course, the clinical examination, Pap smear examination or liquid-based cytology, HPV testing, colposcopy, and then others like auto-Pap cervicography, etc. Now, I would like to talk here about cervical triage screening. This has come up in very big way and it has sensitivity and specificity of nearly 94 to 97%. In this, what you do is that you do a Pap smear or a liquid-based cytology, you get an abnormal smear, you immediately do HPV testing and do a colposcopy, three put together, if they are saying that the woman has CIM3, ensure that she can turn up into malignancy. So this is something extremely important, cervical triage screening. Now, you must know the difference between screening and detection and downstaging. You see, when you do screening, you detect number of things in pre-malignant stage, you detect number of things in a benign way, and all that you can treat so as under no circumstances she goes into malignancy. But when you say downstaging, there are women, old ladies who do not come out and do not do screening, but and they don't come to the hospitals. But these people are very congenial with their people who are there, like ANMs, ASHAs. So these ASHAs and ANMs are being trained to identify clinically what is wrong, and they are given Cusco's speculum to open and see. And then they take the acetic acid, pour it, just apply it on the cervix, and then see if there are any estovite areas. And these women who actually would have come in the stage 3-4, they come in stage 1, and that is how, by using paramedical workers, this was WHO initiative, they downstage. So instead of getting those women in 4th stage, they bring them in 1st stage, and these women can be treated nicely. Now, let's come on to the lower setting screening, where we have VIA. We know 3-5% acetic acid coagulates the protein. Once it coagulates the protein, which is excess when there is any pre-malignant and malignant lesion, so these estovite areas which are produced are suspicious. And then the biopsy has to be taken from them, those areas, and the confirmation has to be done. So it dehydrates the cell, it coagulates, creates an estovite area. So what findings you get is, either it is negative or it is positive. And remember that these areas, estovite areas, what are near the squamocolumnar junction are the ones which needs to be considered. And if these areas are away from the cervix, then you consider them as artifact. So these estovite areas which are near the SCJ are the ones where biopsy is to be taken from. And lot of suspicious findings on the cervix can also be seen, like ulcers, growth, etc. So this is VIA, and this is a very cost-effective test. Just a little training is needed, for even the paramedical workers can do this. Then you use some magnoscopes are given to them. They can apply that and they can see different variety of cervix. Abnormal cells can be seen, too much vascularity can be seen. And if once they are trained, they can detect and send the patient to higher setting. Then there's something interesting, which is Leupold's iodine, which is nothing but potassium iodide and iodine. Now this, if it is applied on the cervix, so we know that wherever cervix has malignancy or pre-malignancy, cells divide. When cells divide, they take up the glycogen. So those areas are devoid of glycogen, but normal areas are with glycogen. So when you apply this iodine reacts with the starch glycogen and gives a mahogany brown color or purplish color. So if you find that the areas are not getting purple color, they are pale, those are the areas where from you have to take biopsy. And if you compare VIA and VILI, you can see VILI have a better sensitivity and nearly similar specificity as compared to VIA. Coming on to the most important thing, which is our conventional pap smear. Now, we all know that years together, all over the globe, in several countries, we have been doing this, and it is done, it is used for mass screening. And wherever the screening has been 100%, those are the developed countries where they have reduced their cervical cancer effectively. In our country, there is still a problem because of some cultural and social backgrounds that the older women never come for the pap smear. We used to have so many camps, but literally we would have to go to their rooms and houses to get them from their houses to do these pap smear. So when we talk about these pap smear, we are actually mainly talking about an Ayers spatula. So there are various variety of a spatula made, but the most accepted one is Ayers spatula, which is made up of wood. And the advantage are that it is very cost effective, it is very cheap, it is very, easily sterilized, it is biodegradable. And most important thing is that when you take the smear and you pass it on the slide, the cells do not get crushed. Why? Because this is a very light thing. And they come in their same pattern, which can be very well visualized by the pathologist. And the cells also do not get stuck. If you just push that one or two, you strike that spatula on the slide, all the cells will come on the slide. And that is why Ayers spatula has been accepted worldwide. Now, if you see that this wooden spatula has got two ends. One is the end through which the blunt end by which we take vaginal cytology, and the anterior bifid end. And a very interesting thing is that the higher one, the one which is little larger than the lower one, that goes inside, and then the whole thing is rotated to 360 degree and then passed on to the slide. Please do not hurry up in taking the cervical cytology. Reason being that the result totally depends on how cytology has been taken. So putting the part inside, putting the larger part inside, and then ensuring that you rotate 360 degree very nicely, and then you pass on this line. And it is expected that you should have an endocervical cell layer, squamocolumnar junction layer, and ectocervical cell layer. That is what is called the best smear taken. So smears are taken by Ayers spatula from both ecto endo cervix. Smear are prepared, properly labeled. They are fixed in 95% alcohol immediately and sent to the pathology department for pap staining, where they are stained with pap smear, mounted, screened, and then reported by the pathology. And the system in which reporting has to be done ideally is Bethesda system. So it's a very simple, safe, non-invasive and cost-effective method, a sensitive test for early screening of cervical for reporting the pap smear, because more and more cases can be diagnosed early, especially if they are pre-malignant. So these are the things what you get in Bethesda. Either you will have a normal smear or it will be ascus, which is nothing but atypical squamous cell of undetermined significance. And then low-grade squamous intraepithelial lesion or high-grade squamous intraepithelial lesion. And when we compare the PAP and VIA sensitivity, you see VIA proves to be a better test than PAP smear if pap smear is not taken properly. Now, I would just like to give you this clue, because you see many of the reportings of pathologists is still as dysplasia and CIN1. So this is what happens. Mild dysplasia is equivalent to CIN, equivalent to LSIL. And basal one-third layer of the cervix is involved. Moderate CIN2, basal two-third layer and HSIL. Severe CIN3, whole thickness except one or two superficial layer HSIL, and CIS is whole thickness, which is HISL. So all everywhere it is HISL. Actually, it should be a high grade in squamous intraepithelial lesion. It should be HSIL. And now you see this. This is showing exactly that lower one third, two third, and the whole thickness. And this is how carcinoma looks like. Also, you will see that number of times grades are reported. Grade 1, grade 2, grade 3, grade 4, grade 5. Now, these are not reported. Only Bethesda system is to be reported. But yet, pathologists are reporting. So, you must know grade 1 smear, if it is coming, it is normal. Grade 2, it is coming, it is an inflammatory smear because of some infection, local or PID. Grade 3, where there are suspicion that there could be malignant cells, some cells are very suspicious. Grade 4, few malignant cells are apparently seen. And grade 5, when you see frank malignancy all over. So I have still told you the old classifications and the new classification, which is Bethesda. So we must know all this while interpreting the results. Now we come on to liquid-based cytology, which has come up in a big way. You see, the problem with pap smear is that once you make one slide, then you cannot do anything because you have fixed the slide and slide is to be seen. But there's a possibility that you did not take the smear properly. So again, this woman has to come back to you and do the test again. If you don't take it nicely, then it is a problem. Number of time, the smear is not well prepared. Number of time, it is not well stained. So there are so many issues. So liquid-based cytology was the one which came up in 1990s. This is to correct the poor slide preparation. And in this, the exfoliated cells are collected by cervical brush. They are transported into a phosphate buffer liquid media. The debris is removed by microfiltration and the specimen is spread on slide, and you can make number of slides you want. You can examine them, you can redo the slides and see them. So that's a great advantage of liquid-based cytology. Another advantage of liquid-based cytology is that this same cytology can be used for HPV testing also. So the liquid-based cytology not only reports the cells what are there, it also can help you testing human papilloma virus. So this is just, we want to show, this is a cervical brush what we use, and then we place it in the liquid media. If you do not have brush, you can take your IS spatula, rotate it 360 degree 2-3 times, and then you strike it in the jar which contains phosphate buffer solution, cover it and send it to the pathologist. So the specimen type is extremely important, because if you do not have a right preparation, then the results may not be good. And adequacy of a specimen, you have to ensure that whatever specimen you take, that should not be rejected and that should be not unsatisfactory. Now, when you go for Bethesda system of monitoring, there are a number of general considerations you have. You may get negative result where no intraepithelial lesion or malignancy would be there, or you may get other results and epithelial abnormalities and glandular abnormality. So negative, you only say when you don't find anything in these cells at all. But you can get non-neoplastic cellular variations, like you may get squamous metaplasia, tubal metaplasia, atrophy, and so on and so forth. And glandular cell status post-hysterectomy can also be seen through the vault. Reactive cellular changes are associated with inflammation, radiation, intrauterine contraceptive devices. So those can be seen. Many organisms can be detected, like trichomonas, fungus, bacterial vaginosis. Sometimes you may see specific changes of herpes simplex virus and so on. And endometrial cells can also be seen in older women, more than 45 years of age, which are hanging onto the cervix. Now, this is something important, that we get epithelial cell abnormality, which are actually low-grade squamous intraepithelial lesion or high-grade squamous intraepithelial lesion. And in this, you can initially get atypical squamous cells of undetermined origin. Then you can get low-grade squamous epithelial lesion and high-grade squamous epithelial lesion. And finally, you can get squamous cell carcinoma. So I have already discussed this, that they mimic completely CIN1, 2, 3, what you get. And then we come on to the glandular cell, where you can get atypical endocervical cells, but they are not significant. But endocervical cells, atypical, where you clearly demonstrate neoplasia. So they could be glandular also. Then endocervical adenocarcinoma in situ and adenocarcinoma. So everything can be detected through Bethesda classification in your liquid-based cytology. Now, once you have done that, you come on to the HPV testing. You see, my colleagues, I would just like to say that we all have become little resistant about HPV testing. Government also does not say that HPV testing should be there. But in all European countries, if you see, HPV testing is mandatory. Because this is a marker. If you find HPV testing positive and you are getting abnormal pap smear, you have to consider that she has some kind of pre-malignant or malignant change and you must go ahead with the treatment. So there are two techniques by which we do it. One is hybrid capturization, easy technique and less cost is there. Or you go ahead with PCR, which is slightly costly, but then nothing is above the detection of malignancy in an early stage. And people do, several testings in big hospital, people are going for HPV DNA testing. Now, this is an algorithm, which I would just like to very quickly state that whenever a woman is screened for cervical cancer with cervical cytology or where you are suspecting, so your cervical cytology will be satisfactory or unsatisfactory. If your cervical cytology is satisfactory, cervical cytology would be positive or it would be negative. If it is positive, then of course my successor, Dr. Sarita, is going to talk to you. What are we going to do? But if it is negative, ensure that your quality is complete and you have taken the smear which also shows TJ transformation zone. And then you go ahead with routine screening or you repeat a cytology or you do several other tests such as HPV testing for knowing that which stage she is on. But if you get unsatisfactory cervical cytology, you have to repeat it for sure and ensure that inflammation, blood, etc. is not there. You do HPV testing, positive, negative, or if you do not test, then of course you have to keep doing the testing 6 months and 12 months, keep repeating the smears. Or otherwise, if you get positive test, you have to do colposcopy to screen her. Unsatisfactory cytology is one of the major thing which creates issue, and whenever you get that repeated unsatisfactory cytology, you must go ahead with HPV testing. So if HPV testing comes negative, you repeat the cytology after 2 to 4 months. Again, if it is negative, then you go ahead with routine screening. But if your repeat cytology again comes unsatisfactory, then you go ahead with colposcopy and also do HPV to rule out any pre-malignant lesion. Fine. So this is what is an algorithm through which you go for unsatisfactory cytology, which is a very, very common finding. So to conclude, friends, what I would like to say that we have to identify cervical lesions visually or by VIA, VIAM or VILI. We have to do pap smear and liquid-based cytology. Depending on what guidelines we are following, you can follow any guideline. You follow ACS guideline, you follow national guideline, WHO, whatever you follow, but do screening with pap smear and liquid-based cytology, whatever is available at your place. Ensure that you can order for HPV testing. Especially, ideally, it should be done universally, but you can do it in some specific cases. All the pathologists must grade this using Bethesda grading and identify these precancerous lesions. And then these precancerous lesions can be evaluated by colposcopy, which is actually a very, very interesting investigation, which my successor, Dr. Sarita, again is going to talk to you. And then go ahead with the cervical biopsy. Now remember, even if you have a lot of findings in colposcopy, the treatment would only be when you do gold standard cervical biopsy, and accordingly you can manage the case depending on the report. So this is all what I had to say. Thank you so much for your patient hearing. And my successor, Dr. Sarita, is going to talk to you. How do you manage these cases when they come abnormal? Thank you so much.
Thank you, Poonam ma'am, for such a brilliant and elaborative talk. I think all the audience are enthralled. All the questions have been simplified and taken in depth. And about the unsatisfactory smear, we were really not aware that if the smear is unsatisfactory, there can be more to it. So I think most of the queries are answered, and we will be taking the questions in the end. And now I request Dr. Sarita from VMMC. Friends, Dr. Sarita is not only onco-gynec, but she's doing lots of society work, and she's a true Foxian. Most importantly, whenever you call her for a patient and anybody is in need, she is always there. Really happy to know her and meeting her through this platform. Dr. Sarita is consultant professor, Vardhman Mahavir Medical College, Safdarjung Hospital. She's president, Indian Society of Colposcopy and Cervical Pathology, 2018-21. She's member Foxy Oncology Committee. She's organizing chairperson, IFCP 2021, World Congress of Colposcopy and Cervical Pathology. And she's done lots of society-based projects for paramedical workers and health workers. And today she would be talking more about the neoplastic lesions, their management, early neoplastic lesions. Over to you, Dr. Sarita. And it's our pleasure to have you here. And in spite of your busy schedule, you have been with us. Thank you so much. And over to you, Dr. Sarita.
Thank you so much, Dr. Seema, for this invitation and the members of the Rewari Obstetrician and Gynecology Society. It's a pleasure to be with all of you. Can you hear me?
Yes, very nice.
Okay. Yeah, so after the very nice lecture by Dr. Poonam, I just want to say that, you know, we have the FOCSI GCPR guidelines. So I think we should actually start looking at them, at the flowcharts of the FOCSI GCPR, which, you know, with Dr. Nija, all of us together, you know, sat down and we have taken up many sessions and discussed the options which are practical for our country. So the FOCSI GCPR guidelines for screening and vaccination, they are up on the FOCSI website. So you have similar flowcharts like you have the ASCCP, but these charts are more practical for our population. Okay, so with that, I just want to, I'll just share my screen. Okay. Can you see my slides?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Yes, ma'am, yes.
Yeah, okay. Okay, so the topic given to me is treatment of CIN and early cervical cancer. So before we discuss the treatment, I'm just going to go with, you know, with the overview of the structure of the cervix and what is the rationale for treatment of CIN. So if you look at the cervix, this is the fundus of the uterus, and you see this is the endocervical canal and this is the ectocervix. And the endocervical canal has these crypts which go into the structure, the stroma of the cervix, and the endocervix is lined by thin columnar epithelium, whereas the ectocervix is lined by squamous epithelium. So a very important thing when you are doing colposcopy and assessing the eligibility for treatment is to know, you know, what is the transformation zone. So once you identify that, you know, half your job is done. You don't have to think much after you identify the transformation zone. So that which is actually sometimes difficult, and that is the most important thing you need to learn when you're doing colposcopy. So when you see the squamocolumnar junction, histologically, you see the squamous epithelium is multilayered, whereas the columnar epithelium is a single-layered epithelium. And this multilayered epithelium, squamous epithelium, appears pink to your on the colposcopy and also while doing a VIA. And the columnar epithelium appears red. So it's at the junction of the pink and the red epithelium, which you should identify as that will be the squamocolumnar junction. Okay, so while now the squamocolumnar junction undergoes a lot of changes during the life of a girl or a woman. So if you see from the birth to menarche, because there is no estrogen up to menarche, the squamocolumnar junction is right outside. And so that is the both the old and the new squamocolumnar junction are this are here. Whereas with the effect at the time of menarche, because of the effect of the estrogens, and the squamous epithelium responds very well to the estrogens. So the squamous epithelium undergoes hypertrophy, hyperplasia. And in fact, there is metaplasia of the columnar epithelium. So it replaces the columnar epithelium here, which was here. And then the squamocolumnar junction shifts up. And that was, so the OC, this is the old squamocolumnar junction, and this is the new squamocolumnar junction. And the area between the old and the new squamocolumnar junction, that is the old squamocolumnar junction here, and the inside of the inner boundary of the purple area is the new squamocolumnar junction. And the junction between, the area between the two is the transformation zone. So you have to identify the type of transformation zone based on whether you're able to see the squamocolumnar junction or not. So if you're able to see the squamocolumnar junction easily without any manipulation, like you see here, this is the type 1 transformation zone. Whereas if you need some manipulation, the squamocolumnar junction is inside, but if you just open up with a swab stick or with the endocervical speculum, you'll be able to see the squamocolumnar junction. So that is a type 2 transformation zone. So if you see here, this is a cervix with normal saline. This is with the green filter. And this is with acetic acid. You see these acetovite areas here, but you can't see the squamocolumnar junction clearly as you was able to see in the previous case. And even now, even on the hyper, you're not able to see, but if you manipulate, this is the endocervical, with the endocervical speculum, you're able to see clearly the squamocolumnar junction all around. So this is a type 2 transformation zone. Whereas a type 3 is when you cannot visualize with any manipulation, you cannot visualize the squamocolumnar junction. So that is a type 3 transformation zone. So this is the cervix with normal saline. This is with the green filter. This is with acetic acid. You see these dense acetovite areas, but you can't see the squamocolumnar junction. And even with the endocervical speculum, you cannot see the upper limit of this. So it is going right in and you cannot identify the squamocolumnar junction. So this is a type 3 transformation zone. So why is it important to know what is the type of transformation zone is? So here you can see in this diagram. So you can see the type 1 is completely, the dark area represents the lesion. So if you have a CIN lesion here and it's a type 3, type 1 transformation zone. So it is completely ectocervical. And in the type 2, it's going slightly inside, but you can open it with some manipulation. So it's a type 1 and type 2 transformation zone. You can treat by ablation, that is just destroying the cells. So because you can easily approach this area, and this in this for the first and the second case, so you can easily approach, so you can destroy this by ablation. Whereas in the type 3 transformation zone, because the lesion is going right inside, even if you apply this, you know, your cryoprobe or thermal ablator here, it's not going to go inside. So you need to excise this whole area. So that is, so this area, the type 3 transformation zone has to be treated by excision. Okay, so that's why it's important to know what is the type of transformation zone so you can plan the treatment. Now, the next thing to identify is if they find that there's a lesion which is acetovite, is it CIN? So for that, the different parameters that you need to assess. So you have a lesion like this, which is acetovite. So you have to look at the margins and you have to see the degree of acetoviteness. If it's a dense acetovite, then it is, that gives a different, it's a, the score is higher. And then what is the vessel pattern, which you put the green filter on, and you look at the vessels inside this acetovite lesion. So you can see that there are some fine vessels here. But if there are no vessels, then the score is higher. And if you have coarse punctation and coarse mosaic, again, gets a higher score. And if you apply one, then you apply iodine. So that is the third step. So if you apply iodine and you see if it's taking up iodine completely, then it is benign. But if it's iodine negative, and you can see it is becoming, it's really yellow. So it's canary yellow. So that gets a higher score. So you combine all these features and this is the score, which is the SWEED score. So earlier we were using the Reed score, but now and there have been many studies which say that, you know, SWEED score is more user friendly and it also it correlates with the final histopathology better. So in the sweet score, you have the SO2 uptake. If it is none or transparent, it is zero. But if it's shady milky, it is one. And it is distinct opaque, it is two. And the margins, so if you, the margins are diffuse, it is zero. If the margins are sharp but irregular, it is one. And the margins are sharp and even with difference in the surface level, then it is two. Vessels, if they're fine, regular, it is zero. Absent vessels is one. Coarse or atypical vessels is two. And the this is the addition in the score, in the sweet score. Where the Reed score did not have this. If the lesion size is less than 5 millimeters, is zero. But if it's involving two quadrants, so quadrants is if you divide the cervix into four. So here you can see in this case, it is involving two quadrants. So it is right lower and the right left lower quadrant. So it is, and the left upper quadrant. So it is involving three quadrants. So that gets a score of two. Whereas iodine staining, if it is staining brown, that means it's not iodine negative, it is zero. Whereas if it's faintly or patchy yellow, it is one. And distinctly yellow, it is two. So like in this case, it's distinctly yellow. So this will get a score of two. So we combine the scores, each parameter, we give a score and get a combined score. So if the score is less than five, it indicates either low grade CNC and one. And if it is five or more, it indicates high grade, that is CIN2 and more. And then you get a total score. Okay. So the beauty of these CIN lesions is they're mostly in the transformation zone because most of the activity is around the squamous columnar junction. And the average linear extent is 7.5 millimeters, so that is less than a centimeter. And vaginal extension is seen in less than 5% of cases. So most of the lesions are just there and they're amenable to treatment. So when you're treating a patient who has CIN, what are the things that you must remember? How do you know, how do we know how much to treat? So as I was telling you, this the crypts that are there in the endocervix. Now the CIN involves not only the epithelium, but it also goes into the crypts. And they have done, you know, in this hospital in London, they actually reviewed more than 300 biopsies. Cone biopsies, that is the whole cervix, the whole cone of the cervix was taken out and they reviewed them and they measured how much it is involving, the CIN is going in. And they found that if the destruction of tissue, if they destroy the tissue to 2.9 millimeters, that will eradicate all the involved crypts in 95%. Whereas if you destroy up to a depth of 3.8 millimeters, that will eradicate 99.7%. So here the treatments that are available for ablation, that is cryotherapy and thermal ablation, they are both very useful because they destroy up to 5 to 7 millimeters. So the most important thing when you're treating CIN is, so if there is a lesion there, you should not just treat the lesion, not just taking out the lesion is not going to work. You have to take out the entire, treat the entire transformation zone. So it has to be effective only if you eradicate the transformation zone. And it should be safe and with minimum risk of complications. So while you're counseling, you have to explain to them why treatment is needed. What are the risks if they do not go for treatment? Although the progression is slow, especially in CIN1, but it can progress rapidly, especially if the HPV is 16 and 18 positive. And this, that the procedures are mostly safe, but they need to come for follow-up even after treatment. So the follow-up is, as they have to come at least 20 years for follow-up. But the follow-up is easier if HPV testing is available. If HPV is negative, then they can come every 3 yearly. Then what is the right treatment? So choosing how to choose the right treatment. So how you treat will depend on what is the age of the patient. So if it's a young patient, you will go for conservative approaches for treatment. What is the parity? Again, if she's nulliparous, again, you can go for ablation. What is the aspirations for fertility? Any previous treatment, she's had ablative, that is cryotherapy or thermal ablation, then she has to go for excisional treatment now. and how compliant is the patient. So if the patient is not compliant, then you must go for treatment as soon as possible. Now, there are these approaches called described, that is a single visit approach, where screen and treat is in public health programs where you do a VIA, and if you detect an abnormal lesion, that is VIA positive, then you treat them by ablation, by cryotherapy or by thermal ablation, with or without a biopsy. But see and treat involves colposcopy, whereas if and on colposcopy, if I find that there is a high-grade lesion, then you can go straight away for excision or ablation. So this is the WHO guideline. They brought out the guidelines in 2013 that if you do have the facilities, if you, for an HPV test, that should be the test which you should use for screening. But if you do not, then by VIA alone can be used, and the following VIA, if the VIA positive, the treatment can be based on the type of whether you're able to see the squamocolumnar junction or not. So if you're able to see the squamocolumnar junction, that is a type 1 or type 2 transformation zone, and the lesion is not very big, then you can go for cryotherapy or thermal ablation. So this is the WHO actually introduced the guidelines for thermal ablation in 2019. And those who are screen positive, either with VIA or with high-risk HPV positive followed by VIA, and the lesion is eligible for ablative treatment, then you can either treat by thermal ablation or by cryotherapy. But if they're not eligible for ablative treatment, go for excision, that is LETS or LEAP. So this is the screen and treat. This is with cryotherapy. So the squamocolumnar junction should be either type 1 or type 2 transformation zone. And it should not be occupying more than 75% of the cervix. So if it's too big, the lesion is too big, and you'll not be able to treat it properly. There will be recurrence. So cryotherapy basically uses very low temperatures, nitrous oxide and carbon dioxide at -68, -89 degrees centigrade. And there is basically cryonecrosis and rapid intracellular crystallization. So basically the cell death occurs by thermal shock. So this is actually... So the technique that is used is a freeze, thaw and refreeze. That is, you just wet the probe with a saline, and you apply the cryoprobe onto the cervix, and then you activate it. So then you have this ice ball forming. So you can see this white ring is the ice ball. And then once the ice ball starts forming, you have to wait for 3 minutes. And then after 3 minutes, you just stop. So then this ice ball actually melts. So there is thawing of this ice. And so this once it thaws, you have to just take it out and then refreeze again for 3 minutes. So double freeze is better. It improves reliability. And there's a lower residual disease rate. So you should always go for double freeze technique for treatment of CI. So that is the ice ball forming. So once you stop, this ice ball melts, and then you'll be able to take out the cryoprobe. Now thermal ablation. Now it was in use actually for many years in Europe and South America, but it was reintroduced recently. And in 2019, the WHO introduced the guideline. So basically it is heat coagulation. So by electricity, this probe gets heated. This is a metallic probe. This is the Teflon coated metallic probe. So the probe gets heated. So it is destroying by heat at 100 to 120 degrees centigrade. And actually you can achieve a depth of destruction above more than 4 millimeters in about 40 seconds. So it is very quick. So the depth, the treatment is very quick. In less than a minute, you can complete the treatment. So this is a video. This is a case of CIN which was treated by, this is from my friend in NICPR, Noida, Dr. Rupa. So this is a case of, you can see that there's a CIN lesion here on the anterior lip. And this is a squamocolumnar junction here. This is lesion is closely abutting the squamocolumnar junction. Okay, so what you do is you have to heat a, put the thermal ablator on, and then, yeah. So you have to keep it on for at least 1 minute, and for 120 degrees centigrade, and then you apply the, you put it on and you apply the heated probe onto the cervix and just wait for 40 seconds. So you can see that now that with the cryoprobe, you have to wait for 3 minutes. You wait for the ice ball to form. Whereas here you don't have to wait. So the treatment is completed in 40 seconds and then you can just take it out. You don't have to wait for it to thaw like you had to do with the cryotherapy. And you can, once the treatment is completed, you can just take out the probe. And in addition, you can actually apply it up to 5 times. So if the lesion is big, you can apply it to the adjacent areas and you can, the whole lesion can be covered. And that's how the cervix looks. And the post-op, the discharge, vaginal discharge, which patients complain, there's a much more with cryotherapy than with the thermal ablation. So as I said, this was being used for many years in Europe and South America, and even has been, a meta-analysis has been carried out. So many patients, more than 10,000 have been studied, and in low and middle income countries also, with very good response rate. And the WHO guideline has said that if there is a histologically confirmed CIN2 plus, of course for CIN2, screen and treat, it can be, definitely can be used. But for CIN2 plus, that is for high grade CIN also, if the patient is eligible for ablative treatment, then thermal ablation can be used. But if they're not eligible for ablative treatment, that is, if it's a type 3 transformation zone, then you should go for LIDS. So these are the recent developments in this WISAP handle device. WISAP is a German company. So you can see that this is a, the, that was a tabletop connected to the electricity, whereas here this is a battery, this you can connect it to the power bank. This is a portable one. And this has a light also where you can actually see while you're doing the treatment. And this is actually has a slider now in, to protect the vagina. Because you'll be taking the heated probe into the vagina. Now, this is the other company which makes a thermal ablation device. This is called, this is Liger, which is manufactured in USA. And you can see this is here, the battery is right, is in the handle, and they, it's provided with two probes. So which you can use any probe, one is, has a nipple. So again, here, the, actually the treatment is completed in a shorter time. Now then, coming to the excisional methods, the advantage of these excisional methods is the entire transformation zone is excised and histopathology of the entire specimen is possible. And you can rule out cancer. There's a small focus of invasion that can be ruled out and complete excision can be confirmed. And if there's any disease in the glands, in the endocervix, also that can be detected. So these are the instruments that you need. You need an insulated speculum. Basically, you need a speculum which has an outlet for smoke. And you need these tungsten loops. And of course, you need glucose, iodine, and acetic acid, and swab sticks. And we should have a, I always use a condom or a glove finger to protect the vaginal, to cover the insulated speculum so that the vaginal walls are protected. And if you have this dental syringe, it's excellent because it goes into the structure of the cervix because the cervix is very firm. And so you need a needle which can actually enter into the cervix. A normal needle, the syringe and needle, can does not go into the structure of the, into the bulk of the cervix. This is very good. It has comes with a pre-filled syringe with lignocaine and adrenaline. Otherwise, you can use the spinal needle and a normal syringe. These are the loops which are made up of tungsten. The best loops are tungsten or steel and very thin, 0.2 millimeters in diameter. And this is the ball electrode, which is for hemostasis. The real small loops, the tiny loops are only useful for loop biopsy. So what you, for LEDs, you need a medium or a large size loop. So this is a video, which is a short video describing the procedure. So this is a trolley. You just have to select the loop which is fit for the patient. Because if the lesion is small, you can use a medium, otherwise go for a large size. That is a spinal needle. And that is a syringe which has lignocaine with adrenaline. Lignocaine with adrenaline is available in the OTs. You should just ask your technician and he'll be able to provide it for you. And that is an insulated speculum. So you need to visualize the cervix nicely and then apply Lugol's iodine. And you have to connect the outlet to the suction for the smoke. And then you then give intracervical analgesia, that is lignocaine with adrenaline. It's very good for pain relief as well as it decreases the bleeding. So the blood loss is almost nil when you're very minimal when you're using this. And then you activate the loop. So when you activate it, before you take it to the cervix, you activate it and then take it gradually across. It should not be too fast or too slow. So it should be left to right or right to left. And that is a cone of the cervix ready to be taken out. So you take that out and then you cauterize the base with a ball cautery. So you must have the suction all the time running because the fumes can just block your view. You'll not be able to see anything. So make sure your suction is working, make sure your cautery is working before you start the procedure. And then you cauterize the base with a ball cautery. Very rarely you need to take a suture, but most of the time you'll be able to use the ball cautery and the bleeding can stop. Some, you can also use Monsell's paste and just dip the Monsell's gauze in Monsell's paste and then you apply it to the base. So that's the, you can see the crater, which is now you can see there is no bleeding there and then you can take it out. So you can see these procedures are so simple, which you'll be able to do in your own clinics. And you can, with this now, with the portable colposcopes, you'll be able to see this, the lesion properly with magnification in your clinics only. And the treatment is also so simple. You can do them in the OPDs or even in your minor OTs. So this is something which, you know, I think all gynecologists will be able to do. And this is, doesn't involve any major skill. So basically, if you find CIN, you have to grade and what is the type of transformation zone. If it is a CIN 1, then you can observe for 2 years. And if compliant, otherwise, if it's persistent, then you should go for treatment. Whereas if it's CIN 2 or 3, and it's a transformation zone 1 or 2, then go for ablation. Whereas if it's transformation zone type 3, then go for excision. Whereas CIN 3, again, if it's TZ type 1 and 2, you can go for ablation by thermal ablation. Whereas if it's TZ 3, then you should go for excision. So this is the, these are the algorithms. This is a very nice article by Dr. Partha Basu, who's right now in the IR, WHO. So the standard guidelines that are there, which involve the 4-step procedure based on the biopsy and then the treatment. Whereas in low middle income countries, we should either go for immediate treatment or evaluation by colposcopy and treatment. So either 1-step or 2-step, because that will minimize the follow-up and that will make you you can use your resources to the best possible extent. Now the I just want to show you these pictures. This is a case where she came with post-coital bleeding, and this is with normal saline, and this is with the green filter, and this is with acetic acid. You can see this is the dense acetobacteria completely on the cervix. This is with the green filter again, and this is with Lugol's iodine. So, what do you think it is? Anybody? And what should we do next?
It's normal also.
It's normal?
No. We have to take a biopsy.
Yes, definitely. Yes, you should take a biopsy and then plan accordingly. Then if you, okay, this biopsy of this, this is actually a microinvasive carcinoma. So this was a microinvasive carcinoma because you can see this, there's coarse punctation here and then there is some mosaic here also. So, and this, you can see it is iodine negative. And you can see this is kind of yellow. The why you can go, should not, you cannot go for a LEAP or LEDs is because this is a large lesion and your loop will not be able to take out the whole lesion completely. So you have, you can take multiple biopsies or you can go for, you know, conization. Conization will be the treatment actually. So this another case, which is we had 2 years ago, a lady who presented with wide discharge and we actually were using HPV testing for a project and the colposcopy showed a high grade lesion. And then she had LEAP in May 2017, which showed CIN2. And then she was coming for follow-up and then she had normal smears. And the third one shows as sketch. And then we did a colposcopy. And this is how the colposcopic picture was. So you can see this high grade lesion, which is going right into the cervix. So you can see this dense acetovite lesion. And here it's also iodine negative, which is, you can see this canary yellow. Now, since she's had a previous treatment, so we went for conization. So this was a TZ type 3 with a high grade lesion. Actually, this video is not working, but okay. So for conization, basically you need to, this is cannot be done in the clinic. It has to be done under anesthesia. So you have to either regional, spinal or caudal anesthesia. And then you have, you have to take, you know, this, you have to take the sutures to stop the, for the, you know, for, to stop the bleeding and then mark out this the cervix with Lugol's iodine. And then you have to, you use a 11 number blade to actually take out the cone of the cervix. I can show it later if there is time. And this histopathology showed microinvasive squamous cell carcinoma. So basically, I just want to briefly tell you about the new FIGO staging of cancer cervix. This was introduced in 2013. The stromal basic stage 1A is microinvasive squamous cell cancer. And so what were the change that was introduced is the horizontal spread was not, is no longer taken into consideration. And for 1A, 1 is the depth is less than 3 millimeters. And if it is 1A, if it's between less than 3 to 5 millimeters, it is stage 1A, 2. Now in the other stage, that is 1B, where there is a clinically, there's a growth on the cervix. So that is stage 1B. So here, the if the, the size of the lesion is now introduced, if the lesion is less than 2 centimeters, it is B1. And if it is 2 to 4 centimeters, it is B2, 1B2, and B3 if it is more than 4 centimeters. The third, now stage 2, as earlier, if it's stage 2A, is involvement of the upper vagina, upper two-thirds of the vagina. And this was introduced even earlier, stage 1A2, 1A1 is less than 4 centimeters, and 1A2 is more than 4 centimeters. And the stage 3 is when there is involvement of the parametrium also, and or there is involvement of the upper third of the vagina, lower third of the vagina. Once again, I'll just have to take this call. Arya, abhi. Hello. Main class le rahi hu, abhi kholti hu. So the intra, the in 3C, there is involvement. The addition is involvement of the pelvic or parietic lymph nodes. Irrespective of the tumor size. So this is a recent addition. And if there is involvement of the pelvic lymph nodes, only it is 3C1, and 3C2 is when there's involvement of the parietic lymph nodes. And stage 4 is when they spread to the bladder or rectum or spread to the distal organs. So I can, if you want, I can carry on, but this just briefly about the staging. Otherwise we can stop here.
Yeah,
only staging or management also we're going to discuss?
Briefly about the management, yes.
I think continue, please continue.
Okay. So stage 1A is when it involves the cervix only, okay? That is only microscopically you know that there is a carcinoma in the cervix. So 1A is the 1A1 when the depth of stromal invasion is less than 3 millimeters, and 1A2 is when the invasion is between 3 to 5 millimeters. So you... So you'll be able to make out only, you know, biopsy of the conization, like you do LEAP, then then you find microinvasive, and then you should assess the stage based on the depth of invasion. And the other thing is the lymphvascular space invasion. So this has to be studied in detail. It has to be an experienced pathologist to look at the depth of invasion and for the lymphvascular space invasion. And 1B is when clinically there is a lesion, the size is depending on the size, less than 2 centimeters is B1, B2 is 2 to 4 centimeters, and B3 is more than 4 centimeters. So that's how that is B1, when it is less than 2 centimeters. 1B2, if it's between 2 to 4 centimeters, and 1B3 is very big. So if it's more than 4 centimeters, so you can see that if it's more than 3 centimeters, you'll not be able to get a proper margin of the tissue. So in stage 2 is of course spread to the either the upper vagina or to the parametrium. So 2A1 is involvement of the upper vagina, but the size is less than 4 centimeters, and 2A2 is when the size is more than 4 centimeters. And this is 2B when there is involvement of the parametrium. So, so there are a few things about the imaging that I thought I should tell you now. Imaging, it's not necessary that every patient should have MRI, and any imaging modalities can be used. And MRI is best when the tumor size is more than 1 centimeter, because ultrasound, the staging is all clinical. So you don't need to do an MRI for every patient. That's only for when you want to accurately assess the size of the growth, especially for a patient who is to be operated. Otherwise, if it's a stage 2B or a stage 3B, then there is no point doing MRI, because you know clinically that there is parametral involvement. And the patient is for radiotherapy anyway. And ultrasound also has good diagnostic accuracy in expert hands. And for detection of nodal metastasis, if it's greater than 10 millimeters, then PET CT is more accurate than CT or MRI, okay, with false negative results in 4 to 15% of cases. But with PET, the problem is because of in our country, there's so much of tuberculosis and inflammation. So in the large nodes does not mean that they are metastatic. Okay, and you can have to go for surgery while you're at surgery. You can assess the extent of parametral involvement also. So sometimes if you are not sure, for the first thing you should do is actually palpate and look for the surgical operability. Of course, with the imaging, it's become much easier, but the extent of parametral involvement, you will be able to know whether the patient is surgery is feasible or not. So why detect nodal metastasis? Because in stage 1B to 4A, 8 to 45% have nodal mets. And if you do not detect, it can result in incomplete treatment. And in terms of investigations, biochemical tests are not mandatory. If you have, made a diagnosis of cervical cancer, you don't have to, get all the investigations done. But most important is you get a chest X-ray and a renal ultrasound, basically to rule out hydronephrosis. Because if there is hydronephrosis, it becomes automatically stage 3B. And cystoscopy and sigmoidoscopy are not mandatory in every case, only if the patient is symptomatic and if it's a barrel-shaped endocervical growth. And if there's a growth, the growth is extending onto the anterior vaginal wall, only then this is indicated. And if you see on cystoscopy, you see that there is an erythema or there is a bullous area, biopsy has to be taken to confirm and to assign it to stage 4. So coming to the management briefly, now surgery is possible as we saw, it's only possible for stage 1 and stage 1A and 1B and stage 2A1. That is, the size is less than 4 centimeters. And for anything more than that, stage 2A2, 2B, and stage 3 and 4, it is chemoradiotherapy. So this the principle of surgery is you take out the tumor and a good margin of healthy tissue, and the draining lymph nodes have to be taken out. So if it's 1A1, you're just taking out this cone of tissue also, that is conization, will be the treatment of choice. But in 1A2, because there is the depth of invasion is more, so you have to go for and there is if there is lymphovascular space invasion. So if it's 1A1 and lymphovascular space invasion, or if it is 1A2, then one has to go for radical hysterectomy with pelvic lymph node dissection, or a radical trachelectomy if it is for fertility preservation. Whereas if it's 1B1 to 2A1, so it's a type 3C radical hysterectomy with pelvic lymph node dissection. It's preferred in young patient, and also in you should go for ovarian transposition so as to preserve the ovarian function. Whereas 1B3 to 2A2, that these are large tumors, so they are more than 4 centimeters. So there is a high risk of positive lymph nodes, positive perimetrium, and surgical margins. So therefore, chemoradiotherapy is preferred because you'll not be able to achieve an adequate margin. And if the radiotherapy facilities are scarce, then you can go for a neoadjuvant chemotherapy followed by surgery. So these are all the guidelines given by FIGO in the FIGO cancer report in 2018. And post-op chemoradiotherapy is given for deep invasion of the tumor, and if the resection margins are positive or the lymph nodes show deposits. So in conclusion, I think, see, if we can all prevent changing of these, CIN lesions to this. So I think all of us, 38,000 gynecologists can surely, make this possible. So to treat it at this stage and not let the patient develop into this stage. So with this, I invite you all to the IFCPC 2021 World Congress, which is going to be held virtually from 1st to 5th July. This year, it's the 17th World Congress of the International Federation of Cervical Pathology and Colposcopy with the theme of Eliminating Cervical Cancer, Call for Action. So as you know, WHO has given a call for elimination of cervical cancer by 2030, where we have to vaccinate 90% of the girls, screen at least 70% of the women once at 35, once at 45, and treat at least 90% of the lesions which are detected. So I think, all of you have to, each of us has to contribute to this goal. And I'm sure with everybody taking active part, we'll all be able to achieve this. And the abstract submission, if anybody has actually been extended up to 31st March. So if anybody any of you want to submit an abstract, you can still do it by 31st. Thank you all once again for your patient hearing.
Thank you, Dr. Sarita. I feel you fully justified the topic, and all our queries, like what I wanted from you, has been told to us. But I have certain queries, like we don't go for cone biopsy in our private practice. Once the Paps or LBC has abnormal cells, we straight away go for hysterectomy. And then, of course, the sample, the first patient may not come for follow-up, and then the cost becomes an issue. And secondly, when we have patients with normal smear, but still they have cervical erosion, we like to do a cautery, and that's cryocautery. So do you recommend, or will that alter the future picture for that patient in case she develops any malignant change? I just want your views on that.
Yeah, so if a patient has persistent discharge, then you should you should take her up for colposcopy. That is an indication for colposcopy. And if you find a lesion, first that has to be biopsied. So the thing is what happens is, and we see a lot of these women coming, they've had a hysterectomy, and within 3 months, they come with a large growth in the vault. And that is because that there was a lesion that was missed. So if we all at least do a pap smear or screen in some form before a hysterectomy is done, I think we can prevent this. So because definitely this would have been picked up before the hysterectomy. And for a CIN, hysterectomy should not be done, because see, if there is CIN3 and there is a focus of invasion, your hysterectomy is very incomplete. and it's definitely going to recur. So it may, you have to explain to the patient, because this is not a complete treatment. Hysterectomy is not a complete treatment. And if it's a CIN, then the treatment can be done. They are less morbid procedures than a hysterectomy. So just ablation or even LEAP is enough for treatment of CIN.
So to add on this, Seema, what madam has said is really wonderful. But to add on this, I had certain things to tell you. Number one is that we getting lot of cases from that Kagajnagar Belampalli belt, where, you know, people are doing hysterectomy without even examining the cervix.
Exactly.
They are just being sent to us. After hysterectomy, when there is future, lot of big granulation tissue, which they say it is a granulation tissue, but actually it comes out to be malignancy.
Right.
So even in the private practice, I request that whenever you have any suspicion, like you do not get the right result, or there is some suspicion, or there is some abnormal smear, you give antibiotic and you repeat the smear and you find again that those things are existing, please do not go ahead with any kind of these management unless you have done the colposcopy and you have ruled out that there is malignancy. And why I'm telling you this is because, you see, colposcopy is not available everywhere. I can tell you number of medical colleges all over India where colposcopy is not being done. It's only pap smear or liquid-based cytology, and based on that, treatment is being given.
So you can just visualize with the naked eye also. And yeah. If you see an acetovite lesion, you can take a biopsy straight away, even without the colposcopy.
Yes, the government is coming up with the recommendation that colposcopy can be done and it should be made available into all medical colleges.
Yes,
this is teaching to the students as well, that they should be trained in endoscopy. So my suggestion would be that colposcopy is one of the very important investigation it should be done and it should be made available everywhere.
So my question is that when we have done LBC, we have done PAPS and there is erosion, and from what our clinical experience, we know that this is not malignant, but still she's having persistent discharge. So we do a cryocautery without colposcopy and without biopsy. So are we justified in doing that?
Yeah, if the pap is normal and it's only an erosion, then you can
having treatment. Having a good smear, which has been reported by a good pathologist, I don't think we should doubt in those things, because everyone is trained well in their fields. So I think only thing is that be sure that the smear is taken properly. If you take half-heartedly smear, the major problem which comes is inadequate smear, it does not show anything, repeat the smear. Those are the reports which are sent by the pathologist. So I personally suggest is that take a good smear, the training is to be given, take a good smear, send it to a pathologist, and if they report nothing is there, please go ahead with cautery. That's not a problem at all. But wherever there is suspicion, wherever you have a doubt, wherever your cervical erosion is not getting treated, ensure that you do a colposcopy or a biopsy and then go ahead with
it. Right. Thank you so much. And I request Anubhuti, there are many questions in the chat box. Dr. Anubhuti, please take up the questions for Poonam ma'am and Sweta ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. There's a question for Dr. Poonam ma'am. It's asked that most LBC reports are inflammatory. And if they are coming repeatedly inflammatory, what antibiotic should be given and what should be the further management for the same?
So, it all depends on what cause do you have. Like if you are that women is having acute pelvic inflammatory disease or a chronic pelvic inflammatory disease, then the treatment becomes completely different. Most of these erosion, which are due to local infection, you give local suppositories and a course of doxycycline and metronidazole, and 7 days course genuinely treats it. But if she is still having repeated persistent discharge and things like that, then, and you have checked the swabs and you are not getting anything, because you do definitely do, whenever you have these kind of erosion, you go ahead with these swabs. So you rule out trichomonas, candida can be seen, you rule out bacterial vaginosis, things like that. So you have given all this treatment, but yet if the erosion is there and it is not getting treated, this is the time, then take a smear, ensure that there is nothing else you are missing, and then go ahead with the treatment.
So ma'am, if it is coming out to be only inflammatory with NIELM and the patient is having persistent discharge, can we go on with cryotherapy?
So this is what the treatment is like, you know.
Yes.
When you give the antibiotic course and it is not responding, you have screened her, nothing is coming positive, you can go ahead with either a thermal cautery or a cryocautery. People are now preferring cryocautery.
Yeah, with recurrent inflammation, if colposcopy is available, it should be done, because there is a possibility of CIN when this recurrent inflammatory smears.
Yes, ma'am.
So 30% of them can have CIN. So you can take a biopsy before, you do a cryo, so that you can make sure that it is not a high grade CIN.
Sure,
Ma'am,
there's another question for Poonam ma'am. Does sampling with cervical brush over IO spatula improve diagnosis in pap smear?
So this is something very, very interesting question. It's been, long time we have been thinking that when you do through pap smear and you do through cytobrush, so there have been very varied literature reviews which have been there. And they had said that cytobrush is much better because it takes up everything and it brings up a lot of cells and things like that. But a very recent study in 2019 has been by the Nigerian colleagues, Rabiu study is there, in which they had single blind trial was there. In that they said that they did not find much of difference if the pap smear was taken nicely and the cytobrush was used. But if you go into the literature review, you will find that cytobrush, some scientists have said that it goes a slightly higher because it takes up all the cells which are there and it puts it in the buffer solution. But many studies are saying that not much of difference is there. So very controversial still.
But ma'am, there is another advantage of doing HPV testing with the same.
Yes, that is with liquid cytology. But not cytobrush.
Not cytobrush.
Take the cells. But once you put it in this thing, you can do DNA testing with that.
DNA testing also. Sure, ma'am. Ma'am, there's a question for Sarita, ma'am. Dr. Malik is asking, on PS examination, if there are prominent vascular markings, what is the significance of the same?
Yeah, if there are prominent vascular markings, it means that the cervix is very vascular. So this can either be because of cervicitis. If you apply acetic acid and the acetovite lesions, and you find these the abnormal vasculature in the acetovite lesions, then it means that there is CIN. But if there is only acid increased vascularity, it does not, the only isolated finding of increased vascularity does not mean it is CIN. There should be a combination of acetovitis and the abnormal vascularity and the iodine negativity. So it's a combination of findings to make a diagnosis.
Yes, ma'am. There's another question by Dr. Sanu. She's asking that what is the cost of thermal ablation and cryotherapy?
Yeah, so the cryotherapy, the machine Indian-made machine that is by Basco, that costs around 20,000 rupees. Now with the thermal ablator, as I said, there are two companies making it. I can share the numbers of the dealers and you can discuss the price with them.
Sure, ma'am.
With the cryo, the drawback with the cryo is, that you have to make sure that it doesn't leak. So, but if the gas leaks from anywhere, it has to be connected to a cylinder. Now, the cylinders need to be replaced and you have to connect it to the cylinder. So, the cryo gun has to be connected to the cylinder. And then all these connections should be watertight. So there should be no leak. So if there's leak, then the treatment will be incomplete. And there have been problems with the cryo, if the cylinder is not replaced, with the refilling of the cylinders. So if that is not a problem, then the cryo is good enough. Otherwise, the thermal ablate with thermal ablation, it's a procedure is very quick. And also you can treat multiple, the big lesion also, it can be treated at the same time.
And ma'am, LEAP is, the LEAP loops, whatever we have, they are of different sizes. So, you know, a small cervix, a big cervix, hypertrophy cervix, everything can be taken care by this. So we all actually, if you ask us, there was a time we were doing cryo, but now all of us have gone into that thermal ablation, you know.
Yes, ma'am. So we should prefer thermal ablation if it is available, as it's safe also. And ma'am, there's another question. They're asking the role of biochemical markers for cancer cervix.
Yeah, so there are, you know, that is immunohistochemistry. But if there is, that is only indicated when, you know, if there is a discrepancy, we are not, they are not able to make a diagnosis of whether it is coming, the growth is from the cervix or it is from the endometrium. Sometimes you have cancers which are spreading from the cervix going into the endometrium. So if there is something like that and you want to differentiate whether it is coming from the cervix or from the endometrium, then the P16 is the marker, because that is the marker for the cervix. But that is not necessary for every case. If you already have made a histological diagnosis of cancer, then there is no need of applying these the histochemistry, immunohistochemistry is not needed to make a diagnosis.
And ma'am, how far like P16 is available in India? How
many is available in teaching hospitals. So not every lab has it, because
not every lab.
Expensive. Yeah, this immuno. Yeah,
and ma'am, it is expensive also. So the cost factor also comes into play.
Yes.
Ma'am, Dr. Alka is asking to repeat, kindly repeat to who require radio or chemo after radical operation, the last but one slide.
Okay. There is deep stromal invasion. The resection margins are positive. So, you know, you have done a radical hysterectomy, but the margins are positive. So there is parametrium. Margins are not free and the lymph nodes show deposits. So these are the cases where it is indicated.
Sure, ma'am. And ma'am, if I would like to ask the organizer, if time permits, can you show us the video of colonization as well simultaneously?
Oh, okay.
Ma'am, one question I had, which I was wanting to ask you. That is that, are we, ma'am, really doing radical trichelectomy? Because most of the medical colleges where we all have been doing oncosurgeries, none of us are actually doing a radical trichelectomy.
Yes, actually the patients don't come in that early stage. And most of the times they have completed their families. So, you know, so radical trichelectomy even...
It's more of the theoretical than practical.
Yes, yes, that's right. Yeah.
Also, ma'am, there's another question that I wanted to ask. If a patient is hysterectomized and a wall smear has been taken, then if it comes out to be ascus or else, then how should we go about it?
Hysterectomy in the sense, if it's a total hysterectomy or is it
total hysterectomy? Total.
If it's a total hysterectomy, then why are you doing swab smears? It's not
needed. If she's having persistent discharge, if she is still having persistent, then the hysterectomy has been done like 6 or 7 years back.
So, wall smear, you mean to say?
Wall smear, yes, ma'am. Wall smear.
So wall smear is needed only if the hysterectomy was done for CIN, not for every case. So if there is persistent discharge, then you should examine the wall carefully. Is it because of granulation tissue? Is it a growth? You know, and do a colposcopy and a biopsy.
On examination, no granulation tissue, but only the discharge. And on vaginal swab, if it comes out to be no growth, then.
Yeah, there have been times, you know, if the fallopian tube prolapse, fallopian tubes can prolapse through the vault and they can present with persistent discharge.
And sometimes the caractropion also forms, ma'am. We have seen that post hysterectomy, the vaginal vault gets, some of the margin gets everted and it keeps on pouring some discharge. And then simply cauterizing that vault tissue helps in treating that.
Yeah, so you can just apply chemical cautery or electro cautery, you think, to destroy this? Yeah, so this is the video of colonization. I was telling you that patient who had sketch after a leap 2 years ago. So you need to visualize the service complete. This is under regional anesthesia. You have put a SIM speculum and then apply Lugol's iodine to mark out the area, because you have to go beyond that iodine negative area. So that's Lugol's iodine is being applied. And you hold the cervix properly with tenaculum or Alice forceps. And then you have to just dilate the cervix, okay? Just dilate, because then you can direct the cone also. And then you ligate the descending cervical arteries to make the procedure avascular. And this also, you can leave them long and that will also help in traction. So you can visualize the cervix better if you just hold them long. And then you also, that's infiltration of lignocaine and adrenaline into the cervix. Okay, this is actually we use the needle electrosurgical excision. So this is a needle which is attached to the same cautery probe. So the needle can be used. So instead of the 11 number blade, here we have used the needle. So the needle is used like a knife. So you have to go beyond this iodine negative area and go into the depth of the cervix, but not straight. You have to go in a slanting direction towards the endocervical canal. And while it's a good idea to actually put a dilator into the endocervical canal so that you know when you've reached the endocervix. So you must always have the suction there because they can be bleeding. There was a bleeder there, I think. Yes, so that the cone of tissue has been taken out. Yes, so the cone of tissue has been taken out, and this is, you have to pack the area, the crater, with a small gauze. So the gauze can be dipped in monsoon space. So that like a ribbon gauze. So that crater you should cover nicely with ribbon gauze with soaked in monsoon paste, or you can just use normal saline, and then pack the vagina also. And because then you'll know if there is any bleeding. Because that, packing the crater is important. Otherwise, the crater, there can be blood collected in that crater and you will not know. Okay. Some people actually do take a suture to basically a locking suture all around the cervix. So that helps in actually exteriorizing the endocervical epithelium. It goes on to the ectocervix. So you'll be able to follow up better when you take pap smears for follow up.
Okay, sure, ma'am. So it was a nice video. And there is one question. I think Poonam ma'am will be the best person to answer it. It asks that how to differentiate the ectopia.
Hello. Anubhuti, just a moment. After this question, we will be concluding. Okay, just carry on.
Okay, sure, ma'am. It asks that how to differentiate between ectropion and cervical erosion.
Okay, so this is a very clear way of diagnosing it, that whenever you have cervical ectropion, that means there have been some kind of, injury to the cervix, which leads to eversion of both the lips. So you will see that on the lateral side of cervix, there'll be tears which would be protruding out the cervix on both sides. So either the anterior lip or the posterior lip or both would be protruding out. In these cases, you actually see endocervix, but it may not be pathological. Fine. So that is the way you see, you find the tears or you find there is some kind of fibrosis which is everting this thing. When you talk about cervical erosion, you will see the endocervical tissue sprouting on a normal cervix. It comes out, and depending on what variety it is, it could be a simple erosion, a follicular erosion, or a papillary erosion, which you will see through when you do colposcopy, you see that. Fine. So ectropion and erosion, these are two different things. If you have done clinical examination of women number of times, you can easily differentiate that this is ectropion and this is. Ma'am, would you like to add something, Dr. Sarita?
Yeah, so ectropion is, you know, that's basically because of the columnar epithelium. But before you label as an ectropion, yes, definitely colposcopy is needed, because, you know, what happens is this ectropion, with the ectropion, the squamocolumnar junction is actually in the right in the fornix. So you will not be able to, when you put in a speculum, you'll not be able to see the squamocolumnar junction, because you can't see it's so high up. So with the colposcope, you should be able to, you have to manipulate the cervix and see the squamocolumnar junction and look at the transformation zone.
Thank you, Dr. Sarita. Thank you, Poonam ma'am, for that.
One question was, Dr. Bijoy had said that the picture diagram which I had shown, yes, has that, but I rechecked it in the image. It says the same for papilloma virus. If the image has been given wrong in the book, then it's a different issue. Otherwise, what picture I have shown, that has very clearly mentioned that it is papilloma virus.
Thank you for clarifying, and thank you, this was an excellent session, and all the queries, all the questions have been taken by experts so beautifully. I'd like to meet again. Thank you, Poonamdi. Thank you, Sarita ma'am, and thank you, Anubhuti, for such a nice presence and coordination, and thank you, Deepika ji, and over to team Jackson Pal, and we thank you all on behalf of the Radio Organic Society.
Thank you, ma'am.
Deepika ji, over to you.
Thank you very much, all the experts present with us today, and the faculty and the attendees. Jackson Pal brings to you newly launched NariCal tablets for all calcium needs. We also have Lycored, the cell protector, which has anti-cancer properties to prevent cancer. Jepitone iron syrup, which is enriched with zinc and vitamin B complex. My teammates, Dr. Vipin Tyagi and Mr. Amit Saxena, join me, Dr. Deepika. Thank all the esteemed faculty present with us today. We hope to go a long way in knowledge sharing with the presence of all the attendees. See you again tomorrow at the Scientific Sangam 3, organized by ISOPAB Prayagraj, which is between 4:30 to 6:30 p.m. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.